Glenn, right here in New York, where we're talking, I know, personally, half a dozen impresarios dying to present you in concerts all across the country, your pick of locations. They offer to pay you any fee that you name. Why do you deny them all?
Because it's not a very enticing prospect, John. It's a very flattering one, I suppose, but it's not an enticing prospect.
The life of a glamorous concert artist?
Is hideous, is dead, is part of the past. I think that that has no relevance to the contemporary musical scene. I don't think it even has very much relevance to the contemporary scene as regards performing music. I couldn't conceive of going back to that life. I was part of it for 8 or 9, whatever it was, rather unpleasant years, rather traumatic years, years which I did it because I felt it was a very good experience and perhaps necessary in the sense of creating an audience which might perhaps buy my recordings. But it was an experience that I wanted to be rid of and to shuck off as quickly as I could. And when that moment came, I did it. And I think it would be a terribly retrogressive step to retreat back into the embrace of the concert.
How long since you've given a concert?
It's about 4 years now. And they've been 4 of the very best years of my life. 4 years in which I've come to terms with music and with myself, qua music, in a way that I didn't realize was possible before. I couldn't possibly go back, I think, to the concert without losing something of that coming to termness. And I wouldn't be prepared to do that because it's been a remarkable experience to start thinking about music, not via an instrument, not by having to decide precisely what Beethoven was really like or Bach was really like, mm-hmm. and in terms of an instrument by which I might translate that decision to an audience. And I've had to encounter a work and an experience of music once and once only, never to be repeated, perhaps, unless some other process like that of stereo 10 years ago happens to befall us shortly, as it well may, I suppose. Never to be repeated, and the fact of that finality is quite staggering and quite impressive.
You mean it frees you to go on to something else?
It frees you to go on to something else. It also intensifies the experience of that single encounter with the work. It means, first of all, that you cover an immense terrain of music. You can look down from a fairly considerable height upon a vast literature that's spread out before you, as you cannot do when you're going from Poughkeepsie to Nyack and playing with the respective philharmonics, if they have such, and on to Hoboken and do it again the next night. That experience does not exist and cannot exist in that particular framework because a tremendous conservatism takes over the concert performer. They're really afraid to try out the Beethoven 4th if the Beethoven 3rd happens up to Len to have been their specialty. That's the piece of which they've had success on Long Island, by George. It's going to be the experience which brings them success in Connecticut as well. Tremendous conservatism, and a stagnation sets in. At least it certainly did for me, and I think it's true of most people. I think that an innate conservatism belongs to the concert experience.
You mean you find you have more options, more choice as an artist this way than on the concert boards?
Well, you have, first of all, a means of really encountering music as a totally enjoyable and personal experience. That encounter does curious things to you. It makes you aware not just of a tremendous range of repertoire, which is good for you by and of itself. It makes you aware of the mental process of assimilating repertoire very quickly, which is also very good for you. But it also makes you aware of the, it sounds a little corny, of the magnitude of music.
You mean you become less of a performer and more of a musician?
Exactly.
Your encounters are broadened.
Exactly. And I...
Well, that's very good for you, but there seems to be a considerable lack of comprehension and a great deal of ruefulness in the musical public and among critics and entrepreneurs, I must say, about this attitude of yours. It seems to get at them and put their backs up. They're still, 4 years later, shaking their heads about it, about your willful refusal to appear in public as if you were personally hurting them.
Yes, well, I think in a way I am, of course, because except for a few octogenarians, I'm really the first person who has, short of having a nervous collapse or something, given up the stage. I don't believe in it, and I don't think most people who do go believe in it. I think people go to concerts because it kindles memories, and they want to do that, simply because in kindling those memories, they feel it in some way. They've got a proximity with music. They haven't, of course. It's total self-deception. And most people who go to concerts are certainly not musicians and care very little about music, I think.
Well, I suppose I can see their point. I mean, the role, the position of a concert artist in our society is a very exalted one. You might almost say it's a throne toward which hundreds of thousands of music students are painfully swimming, climbing, clambering. And then to have one of the most talented, most controversial, certainly a unique figure in music, suddenly step off the throne, drop the cloak and say, I don't want it. I can understand that this disorients them and makes them wonder, well, what is happening to our life? What's happening to our goals?
I would like to think that I've replaced it with some much more viable goal. And you would be in a much better position to talk about these statistics relevant to the matter. I can't claim that recording is the only future for music. Perhaps it's not. Perhaps recording combined with, I don't know, videotape cartridge is the more immediate future or something. But certainly it is one way in which music can be made a much more cogent experience to a much larger audience. In fact, I'm available if they choose to seek it out to a much larger audience. So it isn't really a retreat in that sense at all, and I wouldn't want it to be. I didn't think of it at the time as a retreat. I thought of it as something absolutely necessary. Something
as a step forward,
actually. As a step forward, certainly.
Uh-huh. Well, now, this is what they cannot comprehend, apparently, that the performer alchemy in you is so constituted that you find no handicap in the lack of a live audience. I mean, there are many artists that you know of that say they cannot give their best in a studio, that they have to have a live audience to react with. You don't find this...
No, for me, it's a great liability to have a live audience. First of all, I resent the one-timeness, the non-take-two-ness of that particular experience, you know. And as a matter of fact, I can remember many times when I did give concerts on the North American concert circuit, my performance was going rather inadequately and rather haphazardly. Maybe I hadn't practiced, or I felt as if I was competing with my own recorded version, if such existed. And I often felt that way. And if I was, I was damned if I was going to practice for it, as a matter of fact. And if the performance were going that way, I would be terribly inclined to stop. This is something that, you know, a psychiatrist have marvelous things to say, but I'm sure I'm terribly inclined to stop in the middle and say, take two. But one couldn't quite without risking a bit of a scandal and very bad reviews, and so I never quite did, but I always wanted to.
Perfectly legitimate means of behavior, it seems to me. It's just there's no provision for it in the habits of our concert life. There's no reason why a performer could not say to himself, now that was damn bad, now let me play it for you again the way it should be played.
Can you imagine the reaction if that happened? I'd love to try. I mean, that would be almost worth going back and trotting the boards for, if I could really do that.
Since you don't enjoy giving concerts, you also don't enjoy attending them. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true. I think that the only time when I go to a concert these days is if a work is being presented, which I know I'll have absolutely no opportunity to hear via recording or via radio or whatever. Then I will go. I'll take a tranquilizer, which will sedate me sufficiently that all my old traumatic hang-ups about being up there and doing can disappear for an hour or two. And I'll concentrate on the work, and perhaps that is the one still viable reason for going to a concert at all, to hear a work that cannot be otherwise encountered. I can see a certain utility in that. But I think also that most works that are being constructed today, if that's the word that's in nowadays, for the concert hall, are works which really do demand a kind of eccentricity of microphone employment and so on that you can't have in a concert hall. They really do demand a certain kind of dissection that we just can't make available to a concert hall audience normally. I mean, people try. John Cade certainly tries with the help of specialists in microphone technique and so on, but I don't really think that's the answer. I think that John Cage and others like him should be writing for radio, essentially. That's really what they're doing. They ought not to be writing for the concert hall in the first place. And it's a very curious compromise that they're trying to effect, because they are not thinking in terms of a concert hall audience, and I don't think that most music being written today in a post-Webern manner is being conceived in concert hall terms.
Well, certainly Cage is not writing for a traditional concert hall audience. He may be actually trying to transform that audience to get a rise out of them and get, in other words, feedback from them. But certainly it's not a traditional.
Yes, in some ways Cage is a rather bad example because he is a theatrical craftsman in a certain sense. Karlheinz Stockhausen perhaps is a better example. He ought to be writing exclusively for radio and for records, not for the concert hall. It's idiotic to try and force that kind of anachronistic stature upon the works that he creates. They don't belong in the concert hall. And in the same way, I think that most of us who occasionally go to concerts and for a very special project which can be encountered there and only there at that particular moment, go anticipating the fact that we can't have it dissected for us as analytically, as clinically as we can at home on our relatively good speakers or whatever, that it's a very poor substitute at best. I think that's the most that can be said for it at the moment. I think perhaps there's still an excuse to go to Bayreuth. I've never been there, but if I were inclined to become a Wagner pilgrim, and I do worship at the shrine in many ways, I suppose I could go to Bayreuth and get very misty-eyed about all those who have trodden there before me. I can see that happening.
But that's extra musical.
That's extra musical, and insofar as it's musical at all, it has to do with the association of that particular strand of musical idea with that particular hall, and really, I suppose, only The Ring and Parsifal would even qualify, wouldn't they, in that sense?
Mm-hmm. Do you maintain that even a work like the Mahler Eighth Symphony or the Mahler Second, an enormous work for soloists and organ and chorus, can be adequately presented at home?
Indeed, because as a matter of fact, I happen to be a bit of a connoisseur where the Mahler Second and Mahler Eighth are concerned. I think they're quite the best of Mahler. I think that Mahler was at his best being contrapuntally bombastic and at his worst being influenced by Chinese poetry. Mm-hmm. I don't really think that the thinness of Mahler, as represented by Das Lied and Kinder Toten Lieder in the Fourth Symphony, shows what he really could do, not only with an orchestra, but as a contrapuntal craftsman. I think that that great, glorious mass of texture that we saturate ourselves with in the Second and Eighth Symphony is what Mahler was all about. And I think that's precisely why you will find the Second and Eighth Symphony virtually leading the Billboard charts these days, you know, as I think they do. Because they do so much beg to be dissected and to be analyzed by the microphone. That's precisely what the microphone in a good record production will do for those works and why the microphone has managed to rediscover an audience for Mahler in this last 5 years.
Does the average listener want a work dissected or does he want to be swept away by it?
I don't think the average listener perhaps knows quite what he wants, and I don't mean that derogatorily in any sense at all. I don't know there's any reason the average listener should know quite what he wants. I don't think that I, as a very average car driver, know whether I'm driving a tight or a loose car, as a mechanic might define it. I simply know that I'm driving one, and it gets me there. Nevertheless, I'm probably vaguely appreciative of the things that a good mechanic can do for that car. In the same way, I think that a listener, whether he knows it or not, is appreciative of what a microphone can do for that work. And I'm quite sure that the Mahler Eighth can create a much more overwhelming effect heard properly at home, intimately and quietly and reflectively than it ever can in a concert hall.
Despite the splendor and the pageantry and the drama of, say, Royal Albert Hall...
But the splendor and the pageantry and the drama of Royal Albert Hall has to do with the fact that by George, old Henry Wood got up there for 1,000-odd occasions, and perhaps there are 2,000 people in the chorus singing Mahler Eighth at this moment, and that's really not splendor and drama. It's just statistics, as Stalin said. You know, one man's death is a tragedy, but for a regiment, you know, we can only regard it as a fact of life, as statistics. I can't see that this has any viability in the concert experience.
Do you feel that a person can get everything out of a work, of a piece of music, more adequately at home than sitting in a concert hall sharing the experience with several thousand others?
Yes, I do, very much so. I don't think that the pressure of 3,000 other apprehensive listeners can ever accommodate any one listener adequately to the concert experience, because those listeners are very apprehensive. There's a very curious and almost sadistic lust for blood that overcomes the concert listener. There's a waiting for it to happen, a waiting for the horn to fluff, a waiting for the strings to become ragged, a waiting for the conductor to forget to subdivide, you know? And it's dreadful. I mean, there's a kind of gladiatorial instinct that comes upon the hardened, the case-hardened concert goer, which is why I suppose I don't like him as a breed and I don't trust him. And I wouldn't want one as a friend. I don't really have any concert goers as friends.
You have no concert goers as friends?
I'd have to rack my brains, perhaps one or two way back someplace, but I can't recall any currently. I think also that the concert experience of us is very bad for the performing musician, and I can give you no better instance of that than what it did to me in the few years, relatively few years, when I trod the boards, as they say. I went to Russia about a decade ago, and that was my first tour abroad. Yes, it is that now.
Decade.
10, 11 years ago. And that was my first tour abroad, and at that time I was very fond, as most concert performers are, of playing the same safe set of secure repertoire pieces. One of my favorite pieces in those days was the fifth partita of Bach, you know, the doo-doo-doo-dee, bum bum bum, the nice G major one. It was absolutely my favorite Bach partita at that time, maybe still. So favorite, in fact, that I played it on virtually every program. When I would first play in Leningrad, that would be the feature work of the first half of the program, ditto in Moscow, etc. If it was not on a program, it might even turn up, partially at any rate, as an encore. Mm. And when I came back from that tour, I decided to record it, and it was, I swear, the worst Bach recording that I've ever made. It was also the most pianistic. It was perhaps the one that the connoisseur of the piano would like best. It's the one that I like least because it's least Bach. It's least me vis-a-vis Bach, in any case. It's full of all sorts of dynamic hang-ups. It's full of crescendi and diminuendi that have no part
in the structure and the skeleton of that music and defy one to portray the skeleton adequately.
Accrued bad habits, is that
Accrued bad habits, precisely, and the reason that they got into it was that I had to play it in very large halls, which weren't set up with Bach in mind, certainly, and to try to project it to that man up there in the top balcony. And as I did that, I gradually picked up all kinds of what I suppose Sir Tyrone Guthrie would call bits of business, you know. And I added this hairpin and that hairpin to a phrase that didn't demand it, didn't need it, and that ultimately destroyed the fabric of the music.
What kind of thing? Can you illustrate it?
Well, let me try by playing as I recall. I played that recording 10 or 11 years ago. Perhaps I'm not doing it quite adequately. Perhaps I'm not remembering exactly, and perhaps I'm exaggerating just a bit. Here's a bit of the Allemande. But I'm quite sure that if I'd not managed to mess up my interpretation of that piece by giving so many public performances of it, I might have played it with some regard for the structure of the music, maybe something like this.
Glenn, your voluntary switch from the concert stage to the electronic media of recording and television is very possibly a pioneering step. You're one of the first, and certainly the most important, of your breed to cross that bridge and come into the electronic age and begin to utilize it the way McLuhan tells us it will be increasingly utilized in the future. I understand that it's even gone so far that you are now producing shows.
Producing radio shows, it's relatively easy to do that, I suppose, because there isn't a great deal to be learnt about the technical side of radio that can't be taught by almost any adequate technician. There's an enormous amount to be learnt about the technical side of television. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't dare suppose that I could inhabit a television booth as producer, not yet anyway, and I'm not even sure that I'd want to particularly. But I've had for some few years the idea that radio was being improperly used, that it wasn't being used in a way that was quite faithful to its origins. It's always occurred to me that when those first people sat glued or wired to their crystal sets, what they really were recognizing was the phenomenon of another human voice. It wasn't a fact of news reportage. It wasn't vital weather information. It was the phenomenon of that human voice. It was the sheer mystery and challenge of another human voice being five blocks away and being heard. And it didn't matter whether what was being said accurately or inaccurately or was senseless or serious. None of that counted. What really counted was that there was a voice. There was a way of communicating something, no matter what, one person to another and not being in the same room, in the same acoustical area.
A totally new experience.
Yeah, and what we've tried to do on a couple of occasions with radio in Canada is to create what I've grown rather fond of calling contrapuntal radio, which, as you know, is a term that I've picked up from a fondness for contrapuntal music and tried rather arbitrarily to attach to another medium where it's not belonged in the past. And it's amazing to me that it's not, because there's no particular reason, it seems to me, why one shouldn't be able to comprehend clearly and concisely two or three simultaneous conversations.
Well, certainly not. Our ears have certainly sharpened, I think, in the past 5 years, just through listening to records, for one
Indeed.
Thing.
And not only that, some of our most aware experiences are experiences gleaned from sitting in, in subways, in dining cars, aboard a train, in hotel lobbies, and simultaneously listening to several conversations, or ultimately switching from one to the other, switching our points of view, picking out strands that fascinate us. And we've tried to do this in radio in Canada. I've just made an hour of radio, which had some success, had a lot of critics, of course, found all sorts of ill favor with people who were rather traditionally minded about the experience of radio.
New technique is controversial.
Yeah, but the basis of it was that we tried to have situations arise cogently from within the framework of the program in which two or three or four voices could be overlapped, talking essentially about the same thing, treating those voices as characters, and all of the material which they supplied us with was gained through interviews. It was documentary material, treated in a sense as drama. It was, in fact, a documentary which thought of itself as a play. It was a program about the Canadian North, ostensibly. What it was really about, as a friend of mine very kindly said, was The Dark Night of the Human Soul. It was a very dour essay into the effects of isolation upon mankind. And the five people that we used as characters in this play documentary were all people who'd experienced isolation in some very special way, had things to say about it. And by the time we were halfway through that hour, we had a fair notion as to which aspect of isolation had attracted and repelled each of them and in which way we could exploit that, so that in the second half of the documentary, we began superimposing conversations or phrases, by which time they had become such archetypes that we no longer needed the precise word to identify them and their position. We needed only the sound of their voice and the texture of its mixing with other voices to do this. Mm-hmm. And not everything worked by any means, but I think enough did that I now know how I'd like to proceed. I think that's the way to use radio.
Fascinating idea. Maybe now that the presence of TV has taken the pressure off radio, now we'll become free to invent.
I would like to think so, yeah, because it still is basically my favorite medium.
You said earlier that no one really quite knows how to present music on television, that we're still exploring possibilities of the medium for presenting music. Do you find that you can sell or put across a piece of music on television in performance as well as you can, say, on records or in the concert hall?
I suppose the video track adds something. We haven't had such great success that I can claim to have found one way of presenting music on television. I think that most of us have got an awful lot of experimenting to do before anything of that kind can be claimed as yet. But I think there are ways, and I think we've begun to track down a few of them. I think the most obvious way is to forget all the trappings of television, because, you know, really the problem of television is that it is an incessantly complicated medium, mm-hmm. as indeed radio is not. The delight of radio is that it's very simple, and one can cut through all that technical fluff and get at the essence of something. Now, in television, it's very difficult to do that, because immediately you're confined by the notion that camera three is not quite where it's supposed to be, and if it starts to pull back now, is it going to make a certain amount of noise in dollying, and is that going to destroy something? Well, one approach that we found is to forget about the fact that camera three need pull back at all, or if it does, by all means, let it make noise. Allow the inner workings, the sort of Bauhaus scaffolding of what we're doing, appear. Mm-hmm. Use an open cyclorama, which simply means no set at all. Allow the studio as working scenario to be an integral part of what you're doing, precisely as I suppose Bergman does by having opening flickers on his film sometime, you know, that this is a film. There's no pretense about that. This is not real life. Mm-hmm. This is, for us, at times, a television show. This is not a mock-up of a symphony concert or anything of the kind, or a public recital concert. We don't assume that the audience is being fooled into feeling that this is a concert experience or any experience in lieu of the concert experience, and I think perhaps that's worked very well for us at times.
In other words, really what you're saying is that you are developing a technique for working with television and gradually discarding the old film habits that people have carried into the studio. You're starting to develop a modus operandi for television.
On the whole, I think the best approach to television is to carry over something like the radio habit of 20 years ago, when radio was an entirely spontaneous adventure, and to create a sort of improvisatory, a kind of aleatoric television. And it works awfully well for certain kinds of didactic musical presentation.
Once you're at all comfortable in the situation.
Exactly, yes.
In other words, it can lead you into new discoveries.
I think you have to have basic scaffoldings in mind. You have to know what the form is going to be like in roughest outline. And once you have that in mind, do it several times. Don't be caught up by the idea that one must do it once and decide whether it's good or bad and use it or not. Do it several times. Keep using variations on a theme until you find one way of presenting that work in that form.
Do you think television can, for instance, broaden the audience for music?
Well, there's no question. I mean, television has the audience today, and why we should not attempt to get at that audience via the medium, which has it in its lure already, you know.
Now, traditional thinking will say television exists, it keeps people from coming into the concert hall, therefore television is bad for music.
Well, I think for the very reason that it does perhaps prevent people from coming to the concert hall, it's very good for music. Anything that does that can only be a blessing.
That's a wonderful consistency. Well, Glenn, as we talk, I can see some rather fascinating and strong contradictions thrusting up in your character. You, on one hand, have abandoned a concert career in favor of a more contemporary and electronically oriented career. At the same time, you dislike air conditioning. I've seen you get up and leave a restaurant because it was air conditioned. You dislike airplanes. You are cosmopolitan, yet you hate cities. You don't like New York. You can't wait to get back to Canada. And I know that very often during the course of a year, you'll take off either by car or by train into the northern wastes of Canada to look for, I don't know what, solitude or wildness or something.
Or characters for another radio documentary.
Oh, I'd overlooked that. What is it? What does all this mean? What kind of a person are you, anyway? Do you like cities or hate them?
Oh, I do hate them. And I don't think there are as many inconsistencies as you'd like to find, John. First of all, the recording experience is the most womb-like experience that one can possibly have in music. It is a very cloistered way of life. Mm-hmm. And indeed, I've given up all that was non-cloistered in my musical life. So that there is no very great inconsistency there. The fact of having to make a recording in a large city like Toronto or like New York, where I most often make them, is inevitable at this particular moment. I don't know quite how that could be circumvented. I don't know that I'd want to. I think that 2 days in New York make me appreciate the North Woods of Canada. So perhaps that's a good idea.
But what about air conditioning? Do you like gadgets? Do you like the rest of our electronic impedimenta?
I'm not interested in gadgets per se. I'm interested in what they can do for us, what I can do with them in my occasional efforts in radio, for instance. Gadgets as such don't interest me. But I don't think of myself as being a non-20th century person. I'm not really terribly concerned with contemporaneity either, on the other hand. Mm-hmm. I can certainly see myself leading a life in which cities played no part at all, and if I could build up a sufficient icebox at Columbia Records, that's precisely what I would do. I would like very much, as a matter of fact, to take off for about a year to some frontier experience. And in fact, I may do just that very shortly. I may very well go to the Canadian Arctic and spend a winter in the dark. I've even grown rather tolerant of air conditioning. You know, the Arctic changed all that. I've not had very much experience of the Canadian North, but just enough of it to know that I can put up with and think clearly in much cooler temperatures than I'd ever imagined possible. Ah. And if you've stood, as I have, at Fort Churchill, Manitoba, in 2 feet of snow, 81 degrees in the air, Hudson Bay entirely frozen and with a few matey gathered about.
That's 81 degrees below?
Above. In the middle of June, with 2 feet of snow still on the ground and in high rubber boots in order to encompass those contradictions, you begin to get a very curious barometric sense and shift possibilities become available upon the moment. No, I think that I've become much more tolerant of things like air conditioning.
That's fascinating. In other words, since you have become more and more involved in radio and in television and in recording, do you feel more contemporaneous now than you used to?
That's very curious. I feel that whether it's contemporaneity or not, I'm able to... Well, this sounds like a very conceited thing to say, and I don't mean that. I feel that I'm able to make a synoptic judgment about people and situations more easily because I'm a little bit removed. And this is one of the extraordinary experiences, as a matter of fact, of any situation in which the frontier plays a part. There are more characters per square human being in the Canadian Arctic than in any other part of the world. And one can encounter extraordinary characters who have this ability to be terribly aware of what's going on down on Madison Avenue. Many of them are. Many of them subscribe to Time and The New Yorker and whatnot. And they're terribly aware of just what's going on, what's being written and what's being said, and what next year's fashion line is likely to be. And yet, at the same time, they're completely removed from it. Their decision-making process is not governed by it. And it's the kind of removal that I would like to emulate if I could.
Well, perhaps you feel that the city as an entity is as obsolete as the concert hall.
I've never really thought about that. Ask me that again in a year or two.